This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book Invention and Discovery, Curious Facts and Characteristic Sketches by Anonymous. Chapter 1 Construction of the Thames Tunnel. When the ingenious Miss Pardo visited Constantinople in 1836, she was not less surprised than gratified by the inquiry of an Albanian chief as to the probable completion of the Thames Tunnel. This, however, is but one of the many instances of the anxiety with which the great work was watched throughout continental Europe. In Egypt, too, where a new country is rising, phoenix-like, upon the ashes of the old world, the progress of the tunnel was regarded with like curiosity, participated, indeed, throughout the civilized world. This interest is fully attested by the visitor's book at the tunnel, wherein are inscribed the names of scientific men belonging to nearly every city of importance. The engineer of this great work, Mr. afterwards Sir Mark Assambard Brunel, completed his design in 1823, and amongst those who then regarded it as practicable were the Duke of Wellington and the late Dr. Wollaston. The works were commenced in 1825, and the tunnel itself in 1826, and by March 1827 it had advanced about one-third of the whole length. All proceeded well till May 18, when the river burst into the tunnel with such velocity and volume as to fill it in 15 minutes, but, although the men were at work, no lives were lost. The hole, 38 feet deep, was closed with bags of clay and hazel rods, the water pumped out, and the works resumed in September. On January 12, 1828, the river broke in a second time and filled the tunnel in less than 10 minutes, when the rush of water brought with it a strong current of air that put out the lights. Six of the workmen were lost. For some distance Mr. Brunel, Jr., struggled in total darkness, and the rush of the water carried him up the shaft. The tunnel was again cleared, and the part completed found to be sound. Hundreds of plans were proposed for its completion. The funds of the company were too low to proceed, and above 5,000 L was raised by public subscription. For 7 years the work was suspended, but by advances from government it was resumed in 1835. On April 23, 1837, there was a third eruption of the river, a fourth on November 2, 1837, with the loss of one life, and on March 6, 1838, the fifth and last eruption took place. Thus, of the tunnel, there were completed in 1,836 to 117 feet. 183728. 183880. 1839194. 184076. Leaving only 60 feet to complete. Meanwhile, the tunnel works proved a very attractive exhibition. In 1838, they were visited by 23,000 persons and in 1839, by 34,000. By January 1841, the tunnel was completed from shore to shore, 1,140 feet, and Sir I. Brunel, on August 13, was the first to pass through. On March 25, 1843, the tunnel was opened to the public, with a demonstration of triumph. The cost of the work has been nearly four times the sum at first contemplated, the actual expense being upwards of 600,000 L. These, of course, are but a few data of the great work, the progress of which, for 20 years, interested every admirer of scientific enterprise. The engineering details present marvels of ingenuity. The building of the vast brick shaft, 50 feet in diameter, 42 feet in height, and 3 feet thick, with set over it the steam engine for pumping out the water and raising the earth, and the sinking of the hole, en masse, into the Rotherith bank, were masterworks of genius. Thus far the vertical shaft, the tunnel itself, commenced with an excavation larger than the interior of the old House of Commons. But the great invention was the shield apparatus, the series of cells in which, as the miners worked at one end, the bricklayers formed at the other the top, sides, and bottom of the tunnel. The dangers, too, were many. Sometimes portions of the frame would break with the noise of a cannon shot, then alarming cries were heard, as some eruption of earth or water poured in. The excavators were, however, much more inconvenienced by fire than water, gas explosions frequently wrapping the place with a sheet of flame and strangely mingling with the water and rendering the workmen insensible. Yet, with all these perils, but 7 lives were lost in making the tunnel under the Thames, whereas nearly 40 men were killed in building the new London Bridge, Notebook of 1848. End of the chapter. Chapter 2: Vast Spot on the Sun. Sir John Herschel, when at the Cape of Good Hope, observed on May 25, 1837, a spot upon the sun, the black center of which would have allowed the globe of our earth to drop through it, leaving 1,000 miles clear of contact on all sides of that tremendous gulf. End of the chapter. Chapter 3: Death of Sir Humphrey Davy. It was at Rome, on the 20th day of February 1829, when he was finishing his eloquent work, The Last Days of a Philosopher, that Sir Humphrey Davy received the final warning to prepare. By dictation, he wrote to his brother, who was at Malta with the British troops, "I am dying from a severe attack of palsy, which has seized the whole of the body, with the exception of the intellectual organ. I shall leave my bones in the Eternal City." But he was to die neither then nor there. Within 3 weeks, his brother was by his bedside, and found him as much interested in the anatomy and electricity of the torpedo as ever, though he bade Dr. Davy not to be grieved by his approaching dissolution. Yet, after a day of 150 pulse beats and only 5 breathings in a minute, and of the most distressing particular symptoms, he again revived. Shortly after this, Lady Davy arrived at Rome from England with a copy of the 2nd edition of Salmonia, which Sir Humphrey received with peculiar pleasure. After some weeks of melancholy dalliance with the balmy spring air of the Campagna, the Albula Lake, the hills of Tivoli, and the banks of the Tiber, they travelled quietly round by Florence, Genoa, Turin, slowly threading the flowery, sweet-scented Alpine valleys, to Geneva, where he suddenly expired. It was 3 hours beyond midnight. His servant called his brother. His brother was in time to close his eyes. It was the 29th of May, in 1829. They buried him at Geneva. In truth, Geneva buried him herself, with serious and respectful ceremonial. A simple monument stands at the head of the hospitable grave. There is a tablet to his memory on the walls of Westminster Abbey. There is a monument also at Penzance, his birthplace. End of the chapter. Chapter 4: Homage to Cuvier. When the Count de Cese replied to an eloquent discourse of Cuvier, he stated that, since the Restoration, Cuvier was the second example of fortunate combination of literature and science, and that he had been preceded only by that illustrious geometer, the Marquis de Laplace, whom we may call the Newton of France. In referring to the European reputation of Cuvier, and to the vast extent and variety of his knowledge, he applied to him the happy observation which Fontanelli made respecting Leibniz, that while the ancients made one Hercules out of several, we might, out of one Cuvier, make several philosophers. End of the chapter. Chapter 5: False Estimate of Railway Speed. The ordinary speed of George Stephenson's Killingworth engine in 1814 was 4 miles an hour. In 1825, Mr. Wood, in his work on railways, took the standard at 6 miles an hour, drawing 40 tons on a level. And so confident was he that he gauged the power of the locomotive that he asserted, "Nothing could do more harm towards the adoption of railways than the promulgation of such nonsense as that we shall see locomotive engines traveling at the rate of 12, 16, 18, and 20 miles an hour." The promulgator of such nonsense was George Stephenson. In 1829, it was estimated that at 15 miles an hour, the gross load was 9.5 tons, and the net load very little, and that, therefore, high speed, if attainable, was perfectly useless. Before the end of that year, George Stephenson got with the rocket a speed of 29.5 miles an hour, carrying a net load of 9.5 tons. In 1831, his engines were to draw 90 tons on a level, at 20 miles an hour. When the speed of the locomotive was set beyond question, prejudice then took the alarm about safety, and a very strong stand was from time to time made for a limitation of speed. Even after the year 1849, the London and Birmingham directors considered that 20 miles an hour was enough, but the vigor of the broad-gauge advocates has tripled the working power of the locomotive and given us 60 miles an hour, where we might have been lingering at 20. End of the chapter. Chapter 6. The CRAWSHAYS of MERTHYR TYDVIL. Mr. Crawshay, of the Cyfarthfa Works, at a dinner given to him in 1847 by the people of MERTHYR, related the following account of the rise of his family of Iron Kings, as they are called. My grandfather was the son of a most respectable farmer in Normanton, Yorkshire. At the age of 15, father and son differed. My grandfather, an enterprising boy, rode his own pony to London, then an arduous task of some 15 or 20 days traveling. On getting there, he found himself perfectly destitute of friends. He sold his pony for 15 l, and during the time that the proceeds of the pony kept him, he found employment in an iron warehouse of London, kept by Mr. Bicklewith. He hired himself for 3 years for 15 l, the price of his pony. His occupation was to clean the counting house, to put the desks in order, and to do anything else that he was told. By industry, integrity, and perseverance, he gained his master's favor, and was termed the Yorkshire Boy. He had a very amiable and good master, and before he had been 2 years in his place, he stood high in this just man's confidence. The trade in which he was engaged was only a cast-iron warehouse, and his master assigned to him, the Yorkshire Boy, the privilege of selling flat irons, the things with which our shirts and clothes are flattened. The washerwomen of London were sharp folks, and when they bought one flat iron, they stole two. Mr. Bicklewith thought that the best person to cope with them would be a man working for his own interest, and a Yorkshireman at the same time. That was the first matter of trading that ever my grandfather embarked in. By honesty and perseverance, he continued to grow in favor. His master retired in a few years and left my grandfather in possession of his cast-iron business in London, which was carried on the very site where I now spend my days, in York Yard. My grandfather left his business in London and came down here, and my father, who carried it on, supplied him with money almost as fast as he spent it here, but not quite so fast. What occurred subsequently, this company knows perfectly well. Who started with humbler prospects in life than my grandfather? No man in this room is so poor but that he can command 15 l. Depend upon it, any man who is industrious, honest, and persevering will be respected in any class of life he may move in. Do you think, gentlemen, there is a man in England prouder than I am at this moment? What is all the world to me, unless they know me? End of the chapter. Chapter 7. Weighing Machine at the Bank of England. The most interesting place connected with the machinery of the Bank of England is the weighing office, which was established about 1840. In consequence of a proclamation concerning the gold circulation, it became very desirable to obtain the most minute accuracy, as coins of different weight were plentifully offered. Many complaints were made that sovereigns which had been issued from one office were refused at another, and though these assertions were not, perhaps, always founded on truth, yet it is indisputable that the evil occasionally occurred. Every effort was made by the directors to remedy this, some millions of sovereigns being weighed separately, and the light coins divided from those which were full weight. Fortunately, the governor for the time being, Mr. W. Cotton, before whom the complaints principally came, was attached to scientific pursuits, and he at once turned his attention to discover the causes which operated to prevent the attainment of a just weight. In this he was successful, and the result of his inquiry was a machine remarkable for an almost elegant simplicity. About 80 or 100 light and heavy sovereigns are placed indiscriminately in a round tube. As they descend on the machinery beneath, those which are light receive a slight touch which moves them into their proper receptacle, while those which are the legitimate weight pass into their appointed place. The light coins are then defaced by a sovereign cutting machine, remarkable alike for its accuracy and rapidity. By this, 200 may be defaced in 1 minute, and by the weighing machinery, 35,000 may be weighed in 1 day. An eminent member of the Royal Society mentioned to the writer that, amongst scientific men, it is a question whether the weighing machine of Mr. Cotton is not the finest thing in mechanics, and that there is only one other invention, the envelope machine of De La Rue, to be named with it, Francis's History of the Bank of England. End of the chapter. Chapter 8: Childhood of Pascal. Pascal, the celebrated French philosopher and divine, whose life Bayle affirms is worth 100 sermons, evinced such early ardor for knowledge that at the age of 11 he was ambitious of teaching as well as learning, and he then composed a little treatise on the refractions of the sounds of vibrating bodies when touched by the finger. One day he was found alone in his chamber tracing, in lines of coal, geometrical figures on the wall, and on another occasion he was surprised by his father, just when he had succeeded in obtaining a demonstration of the 32nd proposition of the first book of Euclid, that the three angles of a triangle are equal to two right angles. Astonished and overjoyed, his father rushed to his friend, M. Pior, to announce the extraordinary fact, and the young geometer was instantly permitted to study, unrestrained, the elements of Euclid, of which he soon made himself master, without any extrinsic aid. From the geometry of planes and solids, he passed to the higher branches of the science, and before he was 16 years of age, he composed a treatise on the conic sections, which evinced the most extraordinary sagacity. When scarcely 19 years of age, too, Pascal contrived a machine to assist his father in making the numerical calculations which his official duties in Upper Normandy required. In later life, Pascal found researches in geometry, an occupation well fitted to give serenity to a heart bleeding from the wounds of his beloved associates. He had long before renounced the study of the sciences, but during a violent attack of toothache which deprived him of sleep, the subject of the cycloid forced itself upon his thoughts. Fermat, Roberval, and others had trodden the same ground before him, but in less than 8 days, and under severe suffering, he discovered a general method of solving this class of problems by the summation of certain series, and as there was only one step from this discovery to that of fluxions, Pascal might, with more leisure and better health, have won from Newton and from Leibniz the glory of that great invention. End of the chapter. Chapter 9: The Discoverer of Gutta Percha. The gutta percha tree, or gutta tuban, as it ought more properly to be called, the percha being a spurious article, abounds in the indigenous forests of Singapore, although it was only about the year 1840 that it was discovered by Europeans. The first notice taken of it appears to have been by Dr. W. Montgomery, in a letter to the Bengal Medical Board in the beginning of 1843, wherein he commends the substance as likely to prove useful for some surgical purposes, and supposes it to belong to the fig tribe. In April 1843, the substance was taken to Europe by Dr. D. Almeida, who presented it to the Royal Society of Arts of London, but it did not at first attract much attention, as the Society simply acknowledged the receipt of the gift. Its uses would rather appear to have been found out by the Malays, who first manufactured some of the gutta percha into whips and brought them into the town at Singapore for sale, where they were seen by Europeans. End of the chapter. Chapter 10: Sir Isaac Newton's Magnet. The smallest natural magnets generally possess the greatest proportion of attractive power. Sir Isaac Newton wore in his ring a magnet which weighed only 3 grains, yet it was able to take up 746 grains, or nearly 250 times its own weight, whereas magnets weighing above 2 pounds seldom lift more than 5 or 6 times their own weight. End of the chapter. Chapter 11: Coal Gas in Balloons. Mr. Green has the merit of being the first person who made experiments on the buoyant properties of coal gas. In some of his preliminary trials, he ascertained that the ascensive force of a small balloon, 3 feet in diameter, was equal to 11 ounces, but when filled in the old way, with hydrogen gas, not more than 15 ounces. End of the chapter. Chapter 12: Cuvier and Napoleon. After Cuvier had presented to Buonaparte, in a council of state, his report of the progress of the mathematical and natural sciences since the year 1789, the emperor expressed in a very happy manner the satisfaction which he had received from the document. "He has praised me," said Napoleon, "as I like to be praised." Cuvier, however, as he himself said, had only invited the emperor to imitate Alexander, and to employ his power in promoting the advancement of the natural sciences. End of the chapter. Chapter 13: Last Moments of Leibniz. The passing of the mighty spirit of Leibniz from this scene of existence was a deeply impressive scene. He had suffered from occasional illness during several preceding years. These attacks, however, passed away, and the philosopher resumed his speculations with renewed energy. In November 1716, his complaint returned with great violence. The closing scene suggests gloomy reflections, as the lurid glare which, during his extraordinary life, had attracted the eyes of the world, disappears, while we have not the record we could desire, indicating that the moral sensibilities of the philosopher were rightly alive to the decisive nature of the awful change. His 70 years are ended, and the lightning seems lost among dark clouds. During the last day of his life, we are told, he was buried in conversation with his physician on the nature of his disease, and on the doctrines of alchemy. Towards evening, his servant asked him if he would receive the Eucharist. "Let me alone," said he, "I have done ill to no one. I have nothing to confess. All must die." He raised himself on his bed and tried to write. The darkness of death was gathering around him. He found himself unable to read what he had written. He tore the paper and, lying down, covered his face, and a few minutes after 9 o'clock, on the evening of the 14th of November, 1716, he ceased to breathe. It is most solemn to contemplate a human spirit, whose course of thought throughout life was unsurpassed for power of speculation and daring range of mind among the higher objects of knowledge, and which, at the period of its departure, was in the depths of a controversy about the mysteries of a supersensible world, thus summoned into that world, to become conversant in its final relations with that being who had entrusted it with such mental power, and whose nature and attributes had so often tasked its speculative energies. North British Review. End of the chapter. Chapter 14: Franklin's Discoveries. Of all this great man's scientific excellencies, the most remarkable is the smallness, the simplicity, the apparent inadequacy of the means which he employed in his experimental researches. His discoveries were all made with hardly any apparatus at all, and if at any time he had been led to employ instruments of a somewhat less ordinary description, he never rested satisfied until he had, as it were, afterwards translated the process, resolving the problem with such simple machinery that you might say he had done it wholly unaided by apparatus. The experiments by which the identity of lightning and electricity was demonstrated were made with a sheet of brown paper, a bit of twine or silk thread, and an iron key, Lord Brougham. End of the chapter. Chapter 15: Carnot When a Child. The aptitude and taste for military affairs of Carnot, destined afterwards to perform so important a part in the history of Europe, displayed itself in a singular manner while he was yet a child. Being taken for the first time to a theater, where some siege or other warlike operation was represented, he astonished the audience by interrupting the piece to complain of the manner in which the general had disposed his men and his guns, crying out to him that his men were in fire, and loudly calling upon him to change his position. In fact, the men were so placed as to be commanded by a battery. End of the chapter. Chapter 16. Smeaton's Independence. Smeaton, the engineer, often evinced a high feeling of independence in respect to pecuniary matters, and would never allow motives of emolument to interfere with plans laid on other considerations. The Empress Catherine of Russia was exceedingly anxious to have his services in the formation of great engineering works in her dominions, and she commissioned the Princess Daksha to offer him his own terms if he would accede to her proposal. But his plans and his heart were bent upon the exercise of his skill in his own country, and he steadily refused all the offers made to him. It is reported that when the princess found her attempts unavailing, she said to him, "Sir, you are a great man, and I honor you. You may have an equal in abilities, perhaps, but in character you stand single." The English minister Sir Robert Walpole was mistaken, and my sovereign, to her loss, finds one who has not his price. After Smeaton had retired from his profession, he was often pressed to superintend certain works. When these entreaties were backed by personal offers of emolument, he used to send for an old woman who took care of his chambers in Gray's Inn.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.